Welcome back to Suraj Podcast. In the last episode, we heard how the Raja Bhimchand had orchestrated this scheme. He was sending a minister over to the court of Guru Gobind Singh, planning to get the Prasadi elephant, the Prasadi Hathi of Guru Gobind Singh. So chapter 32 now begins describing how Anandpur, the minister of Guru Gobind Singh, clasps hands together and says to Guru Gobind Singh, he says, Bhimchand, the mountain king, he has sent over a minister. May we call him now, so he may obtain the darshan of your lotus-like feet? And then, taking the permission of the Guru, Anandpur then had the minister called, who came very quickly. Arriving within the congregation, he was holding offerings, and then he bowed his head. Where the Ardasya Sikh, the Sikh who performs the Adas, said, there he went and sat with some fear in a closed posture, pulling his limbs together. He saw the radiance, the great glory of the Guru. The throne looked as if it was the throne in heaven, with Indra seated there, the god of the devtas. He clasped his hands together and then he let out a request. He said, the king bows to you. He places his head at your feet, and he has a great desire to be the slave of your slave. Guru Gobind Singh then proclaimed from his lotus-like exultant mouth, the grand hail ruler, Bhimchand, is he well? Where is he now? Where did he go when he left from here? Tell us the reason for your arrival. For what task did the king send you here? Hearing this, the minister then responded, telling the Guru that the king is well. When the king obtained your darshan, divine sight, from that moment he's been speaking about you, about your extensive qualities to everybody. He would say, the Guru, what a splendid nature he has. So enjoyable, so sweet, so strong and impressive, attractive, a true heart stealer. This portion of our region has been so blessed since the lotus-like feet of the Guru has tread on it. It is beneficial to all people. Some people listen to your words, Gurbani. Other people obtain the Guru's darshan. All of these people, their sins will fade away. Where a tiger remains, what is the fear of an elephant? Everyone has obtained such a rare darshan, divine sight of yours, and the Guru has purified this land. Bhimchand would praise your many qualities in this way. And all the other kings in this region have been listening to this. From the region, he hasn't gone anywhere. He just enjoyed your bliss from his time here, and then he's savoring that at home. And about the reason for my arrival, please listen, Divine Prabhu. The king has sent me with love here. He clasped his hands together and he has said, with love, I have a great desire for the Guru's lotus-like feet. The Guru should recognize that whatever land I have within my kingdom, the Guru should roam and enjoy it freely. Just like the Guru places his command over me, in the same way may the Guru place his grace upon me. The horses, elephants, and alike within my treasury, my house, whatever is within it, he may request and see them all. I have the desire to have the Guru's lotus-like feet placed in my house. And since I've met with him, I've been so excited about it. Now, whatever items are within my house, whatever desire the Guru has in his heart, he should understand that without any hesitation or difference, that these, all of these items are his as well. He may request any of these like they are his own. In my mind, I was so delighted since we met. So this is what the hill ruler, Bhimchand, had told me to tell you, with great love. This idiot minister was speaking so deceitfully, lying, understanding the divine Guru, well, just like some other hill king. He was speaking so delightfully, like a peacock, but if judging by his action, he looked like he was eating worms. Speaking to convey a friendship with the Guru, but desiring to perform such a vile action, like the deceit of a snake in the forest. Now this is a gesture towards popular folktale, speaking of the nature of ungrateful people, where a snake was stuck in the forest fire when a rider on horseback came by, and the snake spoke very sweetly and convinced the rider to help him, so he climbed up on the rider's spear, and at some point after escaping the fire, the snake then bit the rider. So this is an old folk tale, but this is a gesture to that. The text continues, it says, it was like a gold pot filled with poison, or like a fruit created with both, sweetness, and poison. Externally, he was speaking with such value, such worth, but internally, it was as if he had mixed poison with his words. What similarity, what metaphor, what analogy can I say in reference to this deceitful speech? Like he was putting up a cloth to deceive the audience, like he's an actor of some sort. He was speaking in this gratefully deceitful manner so that the divine would give over his elephant. Now listening to this, the minister of the Guru, Nand Chand, then he said, if the Raja has this desire in his mind, then speaking delightfully is always the best way forward, so that love between two parties can further grow. In the Guru's house, with whatever desire one approaches it with, one receives the fruit of that without any delay. Those who reside near the Guru, if they always have love, or if they have jealousy, they'll receive great happiness or constant pain. The mind always remains in these two states of happiness and sadness. So, regardless if one is a king or a beggar, whoever wishes best, they will always have a straightforward heart. They will always be honest while remaining with the Guru. The minister heard this and responded, the king wants this from the Guru, the great splendor in this world, and to have great peace in the afterlife as well. And now for the glory in this world, he has sent me here, understanding that the engagement of his son is approaching. The king of Srinagar, Fateh Shah, who is in possession of such a fine grand treasury, with military might, extraordinary glory, to his daughter has the king Bhimchand engaged his son to, and now wants to send his son there to marry her. We have heard that the first wedding party will arrive to our house, and we have been preparing for that. So for that festival, we desire the best of all items, those items which we do not have in our house. We are requesting them from outside. The kings and beggars are actually alike. Without asking from other people, no task would be fulfilled. If we look around at other hill kings in this region and think about it, they are not as big, as important as us. It doesn't look right for us to be asking from them. None of them look as great as you do. If we think properly about it, then besides you, all the other kings are minor. Our child, Bhimchand's child, is the Guru's child. Understand this firmly in your heart. This is why I was sent to you. He praised you greatly. He told me to go bring back the Prasadi elephant. The Guru will keep our honor. In the Guru's house, they have such wondrous rare items, and seeing the splendor, the drama, the play of them, everybody will be so delighted. Bring them just this one time so we can show them at our wedding festival to the wedding party. And after that, we will send it back, that elephant which people will see with great shock and joy. Now, we will tell Fateh Shah and all the others about the rare items, wondrous items within the Guru's house. We'll spread greatly your praise. This is why I've come here. The king has sent me here to you. The knower of all hearts, Guru Gobind Singh, hearing the words filled with deceit and falsehood, understood the truth of the matter. And Guru Gobind Singh, the ocean of virtue, he understood the Pahari, the hill rulers, to have such unripe, fragile intellect. They adorn great falsehood and speak it like it's truth. If the elephant was given now at this time, then after this time, they will continue to have conflict and disputes with us. These idiots will not give it back. They will think grandly of their wit and their smarts. And then, after that, a great war will still take place. The hill rulers, in their arrogance, will act out these transgressions. Such vile behavior. That's why it doesn't make sense to give the elephant now. And in contrast to this, fighting with them is more pleasing to me. Thinking about this, the Guru of the world then said, this Prasadi elephant was given to us by one Sikh with a great desire in his mind. It was his faith, his desire that the Guru keep it for himself. This was the Sikh's desire from his heart, saying that we should not give it to anybody else. Just ride it for yourself and enjoy. In many ways, this elephant is greatly rare. People come from all over to see it. In the Guru's house, it has always remained this routine, this tradition, that the Guru behaves as his beloveds desire him to. We fulfill the desire of our Sikhs. We never forget them. We never push their wishes away. That's why you should go to the king and say, well, we have another elephant. Ask the king if they would want to take that, so they could show it off at the wedding party. Hearing this, the minister remained quiet. He understood that the Guru would not give the elephant. And seeing the expression on the Guru's face, he took his leave After bowing down, he set off on the trail. In his heart, he was extremely disappointed. His face wilted. His task was not fulfilled. In great shame, he was heading back to the king. He understood Guru Gobind Singh as a knower of all hearts, that he had understood what was happening. He understood the deceit, the corrupt plan the hill ruler had schemed. He had now entered back into the city. In his heart, he was just overrun with thoughts about it all. And that's how chapter 32 concludes. In the next chapter, we're going to hear about this discussion and what happens in the court of Bhimchand. So that's what we're going to pick up next time. But as always, we'd like to thank those who have been supporting the podcast through the Mangalacharan Patreon page.
ਜਿਹੜਾ ਪਾ ਕੇ ਆਉਣਗੇ ਗੁਰਾਂ ਦੇ ਪਿਆਰੇ ਜਿਕਾਉਣਗੇ ਜਿਕਾਰੇ ਗੱਜ ਕੇ ਜਗਾਇਆ ਜਾਵੇ ਨਾਲ ਹੋ ਜਾਵੇ।